गुड मॉर्निंग सर। सर का म्यूटेड है।
चलिए स्टार्टअप कर सकते हैं।
हाँ
या गुड मॉर्निंग, नाउ आई एम अनम्यूटेड।
ओके सर।
वेलकम।
हेलो। हाँ मैम, कैन यू हियर मी? यस
यस
ओके मैम।
गुड मॉर्निंग डायरेक्टर सर। रेस्पेक्टेड डायरेक्टर सर एंड माय डियर कोलीग्स, वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू। वेलकम टू दिस सेशन ऑफ क्लिनिकल सोसाइटी मीटिंग। इन टुडेज प्रेजेंटेशन वी हैव टू प्रेजेंटेशंस, वन फ्रॉम द यूनिट 3 ऑफ मेडिसिन एंड द अदर फ्रॉम द यूनिट सी ऑफ जनरल सर्जरी। So we'll start with first with a presentation from general medicine. And here we all know as clinicians that fever is one of the most difficult diagnosis to make for all clinicians. And today we'll present a pyrexia for unknown origin, in which we had a lot of dilemmas and confusions. So I'll request Dr. Sumit to make that presentation on behalf of Unit 3.
Thank you, ma'am. A very good morning and warm welcome to all my respected teachers and my dear colleagues in today's clinical society meeting. Today we are going to discuss a case on pyrexia of unknown origin, which was a diagnostic dilemma from Unit 3, Department of General Medicine. Our patient was a 56-year-old female, resident of Madhubani, Bihar, housewife. She was a known case of type 2 diabetes and hypertension, presented to us on 30th June this year with chief complaints of fever, from 3 months and generalized weakness from 3 months. The fever was recorded up to 103 degree Fahrenheit, temporarily responded to antibiotics and antipyretics. It used to recur every third to fourth day. It was associated with chills but not rigor. The patient also complained of significant weight loss and loss of appetite. There was generalized weakness from 3 months in the form of easy fatigability in doing normal daily activities. There was no history of headache, altered sensorium, cough or shortness of breath, palpitation, syncope or chest pain. There was no history of pain abdomen, distension, diarrhea or jaundice or burning micturition. There was also no history of any oral ulcer, photosensitivity or rash or joint pain. The patient was a known case of type 2 diabetes from 10 years. He was currently on 20 mg teneligliptin with 500 mg metformin. Also a known case of hypertension from 10 years. She was currently on telmisartan 40 mg. The patient was hospitalized 3 times in last 3 months for her fever, during which she received following antibiotics like meropenem and vancomycin for 11 days in first half of May, natalmycin for 1 week and piperacillin tazobactam for 2 weeks in last week of May, amoxicillin clavulanic acid for 10 days in last week of June, but her fever recurred every time. She was quite well extensively worked up before. Here we can see that her, in the course of illness, her hemoglobin was falling gradually. Her counts was raised in the range of 20,000 persistently with neutrophil percentage of more than 80%, and her gradual transaminitis developed. She was treated as pneumonia and UTI in May and June. Repeated RT-PCRs for SARS coronavirus 2 were negative. She undergone CT thorax and abdomen on 16th June, which showed multiple lymph nodes in pre and paratracheal and bilateral axillary group of lymph nodes of size 1 into 1 cm with mild hepatosplenomegaly, liver of size 16 cm and spleen 12.3 cm with normal ecotexture. FNAC of axillary lymph nodes also showed reactive lymphoid hyperplasia. Based on these reports, she was started on ATT 2 weeks back by a local practitioner, and there was no history of any prior COVID vaccination. Her family history and personal history were non-contributory. She attained menopause 8 years back with 2 live children and no dead issues. Now on examination, the patient was well oriented to time, place and person, febrile with 103 degree Fahrenheit and sick looking. Pulse was 124 beats per minute, regular, rhythmic, normal volumic, normal character, all peripheral pulses palpable with no radioradial delay or radiofemoral delay. Her blood pressure was 130 by 86 millimeter mercury in right arm supine position. Respiratory rate of 20 per minute with saturation of 97% in room air. On general examination, she had pallor and pedal edema, but icterus, cyanosis, clubbing and lymphadenopathy were absent. JVP was not raised. On systemic examination, CNS, CVS, respiratory examination were within normal limit. On per abdomen, soft, non-tender with no palpable organomegaly. She had diffuse muscle tenderness, however, no joint swelling or tenderness was present. Now, after history and examination, our case was a 56-year-old female. She was a known case of type 2 diabetes with hypertension, currently on ATT, with high-grade intermittent fever from 3 months, with pallor, with pedal edema, with lymphadenopathy and hepatosplenomegaly on the basis of imaging. After this clinical scenario, we had a case of pyrexia of unknown origin, of which the differential would be as follows. It may be infection like tuberculosis, infective endocarditis, HIV, or any deep-seated abscess or other infections, and malignancy like leukemia or lymphoma, or any connective tissue disorder like SLE, vasculitis, or adult Still's disease, or other causes like sarcoidosis or thyrotoxicosis. Now, we approached the patient with the basic lab investigations, which was showing an anemia of 7.7 gram per DL, increased counts with 32,000, with neutrophil predominance of 87%, with platelets normal of 1.5 lakh. Her MCV was 72 femtoliter. Her paracheck, dengue check, typhidot, IgM scrub typhus, and IgM leptospirosis were all negative. Her urine RM showed 8 percels with 15 RBCs with plus 1 protein. On admission, her random blood was 300 mg per dl. Her serum creatinine and urea was 2.3 by 72 mg per dl. Her SGOT-SGPT was 214 by 240 units per liter. Total protein albumin was 6 by 2.8 gram per dl. Her bilirubin was within normal limit. LDH was 1000 units per liter. Her calcium phosphate was within normal limit. Her chest X-ray and ECG were within normal limit. On the time of admission, her COVID RT-PCR was negative. So with this, on the management, on day one, we started with empirical antibiotics like meropenem 500 mg 12 hourly renal modified dose and lanazolid 600 mg 12 hourly. ATT was continued, OHA were withheld and was kept on basal bolus insulin. Her general blood picture, bone marrow, collagen profile and other investigations were sent. Her other investigation showed mild marker were negative, her 2D echo was within normal limit with no regional wall motion abnormality or no clots or vegetations. Her repeated blood culture and urine culture were sterile. Stool OB was negative. Her lipid profile showed a mild triglyceridemia of 430 mg per dl and low HDL of 16. Her ANA was negative. CPK was 197 units per liter and HbA1c was 9.9%. Now by day 4, the patient was still febrile. The temperature was being recorded continuously up to 102 degrees Fahrenheit. Her OTP, her SGOT-SGPT also showed persistent transaminitis. By this time, her repeat urine RM showed 4 percels, 4 RBCs with plus 1 protein. On day 4, by evening, the patient complained of sudden onset chest discomfort in the form of chest tightness with anxiety and sweating. On evaluation, the ECG done, which showed normal sinus rhythm with heart rate of around 140 per minute with normal nexus with ST segment elevation in lead 1 and AVL with ST depression in lead V1, V2, V3 and lead 3. At this time, her cardiac profile was within normal limit. So consequently, loading dose of aspirin 300 mg, clopidogrel 300 mg with atorvastatin 80 mg were given with sorbitrate 5 mg sublingual with injection low molecular weight was started. Low molecular weight heparin was started. Cardiology reference were taken. At this time, the 2D echo showed no apparent regional wall motion abnormality at rest with ejection fraction of 60%. The patient was advised for thrombolysis, but the attendant denied. Gradually, the patient's chest pain improved, but a fever was still persisting. A repeat ECG and cardiac profile after 8 hours showed no ST elevation, but her cardiac profile was positive with CKMB and tropi were positive. The patient was continued on dual antiplatelets, that is aspirin and clopidogrel of 75 mg each with atorvastatin of 40 mg with injection low molecular weight heparin was continued. Coronary angiography was advised. Now by this time, the peripheral blood smear and bone marrow arrived. Now I would like to request Dr. Deeparani ma'am to kindly come and give her expert opinion.
Very good morning to respected seniors and dear colleagues. In the peripheral blood smear, the RBC showed mild anisopoikilocytosis with presence of normocytic normochromic cells with few macrocytes and macrovellocytes. Total leukocyte count was raised, and there was a leukocytosis. In the differential leukocyte count, there was mild left shift with myelometer myelo 4%, and there was neutrophilia, 74% neutrophil was seen. The neutrophils showed toxic granules, and few band forms and ring forms of neutrophils were also seen. Platelets were adequate. This is a picture, the scanner view of the peripheral blood smear showing leukocytosis at the tail end of the smear. At 40x, we can see these myelocytes and a few band forms. At 100x, we can appreciate these toxic granules present in the neutrophils. Bone marrow aspiration smears were diluted with blood and showed 1 to 2 hypercellular particles. Trace were hypercellular. The ME ratio was 6:1. Erythropoiesis was mixed type. It was dimorphic. Micronormoblasts and few late megaloblasts were seen. Myelopoiesis showed neutrophil 50%. It means it was the smear was diluted with blood. Occasional giant metamyelocytes and giant band forms were seen. Myeloid precursors showed coarse granules. Megakaryopoiesis was normal. Megakaryocytes were seen normally, both in number and morphology. This is a picture in the scanner view showing the hypercellular particle and the dilated bone marrow smears. In this picture, we can appreciate these megakaryocytes and with hypercellular trails. This is a picture showing the myeloid and erythroid precursors in the bone marrow. At the 100x, we can see these granules present in the myeloid precursors, and these erythroid precursors are also seen. On the basis of the above finding, all the features were suggestive of acute infection with dimorphic anemia, and we suggested for anemia profile and follow-up of the patient's GBP and CBC after treatment of infection. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Now, by day 5, the patient developed rashes on the body. On examination, the rashes were on chest and abdomen. They were diffuse, erythematous, with plaque and papule, palpable and non-scarring. After seeing the, rashes...
Video bhi, bolenge ki bhi video dikhao to. Kaun sa button dabana
rahe?
Can you just mute yourself?
After development of rashes, on further inquiring, the patient said that she had 2 episodes of such transient reddish rash, which were non-itchy, in the past 2.5 months. It used to subside on its own. On other investigations, her iron profile was within normal limit, with iron of 60 microgram per dl and saturation of 24%. Her RF factor was normal, anti-CCP was negative, collagen profile were all negative, C3, C4 was normal, and her thyroid profile showed hypothyroidism of TSH 12.3. Now, with preceding investigations, her procalcitonin was 0.8, her D-dimer was raised of 10, normal was less than 0.5, ferritin was highly raised of 90,000, CRP was 209, which was also highly raised, her IL-6 was within normal limit, and her COVID antibody was positive for both IgM and IgG, though her IgG was more strongly positive. Now, after history examination and investigations, our patient was a 56-year-old female with 3 months of persistent fever and intermittent rash on the background of persistent leukocytosis and hyperferritinemia led to the suspicion of adult onset Still disease, query COVID-19 associated. Now, revisiting Yamaguchi criteria, we could see that our patient satisfied it. Amongst major criteria, our patient had fever, typical evanescent rash, leukocytosis with neutrophilia. Amongst minor criteria, our patient had lymphadenopathy, splenomegaly, transaminitis, and negative test for ANA and RF factor. And our patient also satisfied the exclusion criteria. So we could see that our patient had more than 5 criteria, in which more than 2 major criteria was being satisfied with no exclusion criteria. So we consequently, the patient was put on omnacotyl 50 mg daily, antibiotics and ATT was stopped from day 5. The patient became afebrile after day 3 of steroid initiation, and the counts also improved from 24,000 to 13,000. The rash also subsided gradually. On discharge, the patient was discharged on day 13 with prednisolone 50 mg daily on divided doses of 30 mg and 20 mg and other medications for her comorbidities. Now, on follow-up, we could see a patient showed improvement clinically as well as from lab parameters. On admission, she was febrile for 8 days. She was febrile, and then after, she was afebrile for the next follow-up. Her hemoglobin also showed an improving trend. Her counts also decreased from 13,000 on discharge to 7,000 by 2 months. Her transaminitis also settled by 2 months. her ferritin, which was 20,000, which was 2,000 on discharge, also settled and became within normal limit by 2 months. The patient was given prednisolone 50 mg divided doses for 1 month, and then after, the prednisolone was gradually tapered by 10 weeks by 10 mg per week. On follow-up, a CT coronary angiography was there, which showed 70% stenosis in proximal segment of left anterior descending artery, and there were soft plaques seen in proximal segments of left circumflex artery and right coronary artery with no significant narrowing. So on discussion part, adult onset Still's disease is rare, multisystem immune inflammatory disease characterized by fever, evanescent rash and arthritis. The cases lie between 15 to 25 years and 36 to 40 years of age. Viral or bacterial infection have been proposed as potential trigger, but exact mechanism underlying Still's disease remain largely unknown. Phenotypically, it is of two types, systemic Still's disease or articular. Our patient had systemic Still's disease because she came with systemic symptoms like fever and serositis. The disease course can be monophasic, intermittent, or chronic pattern. Our patient had monophasic pattern. Well, pertaining to our patient, Still's disease came on the background of COVID-19. So in reviewing literature, we found that they both share common pathogenic pathways, and common role of IL-1 and pathogenesis of Still's disease and COVID-19 could explain close similarities between both diseases. A potentially misdirected immune response against SARS coronavirus 2 could have triggered disease onset of Still's disease. On reviewing literature, we could find a couple of articles related to occurrence of Still's disease after COVID-19. But in the first article, the Still's disease occurred after 6 months of COVID-19, and in the next, it occurred after 6 weeks of COVID-19. Well, both these patients had positive RT-PCR with them, but our patient never came RT-PCR positive, but her COVID antibody titer was highly positive. So in comparative result between both COVID-19 and Still's disease, we could see that COVID-19 occurred in much older age with male predominance for COVID-19. And IL-6 profile, IL-6 level was also increased in COVID-19. Well, ferritin was more increased in active Still's disease, and COVID-19 came with more respiratory involvement. On treatment part, NSAIDs, 20% of patients achieve control with it. Steroids are the mainstay of treatment. And for pulse steroid, we give for life-threatening disease or not responding to oral steroids. For steroid-sparing agent, we can use methotrexate. And for targeted therapies, we use anti-TNF agents and tocilizumab, which is IL-6 inhibitor, primarily in articular disease, and anakinra, IL-1 inhibitor, which is mainly used in systemic type or refractory types, refractory to steroids, methotrexate, and etanercept. Thank you.
Thank you, Sumit, for your nice presentation. So coming to the first question, I will request Dr. Ishan to unmute himself and ask his question.
So Dr. Ishan actually wanted to see the radiology.
Dr. Ishan was asking for the CT images. So CT images of the patients, CT thorax and CT abdomen.
Actually, we did not include that in our presentation, but this CT images, which is just done before coming to the hospital here, and it was discussed over here, and they collaborated the same findings, but we have not shown that CT images here because it was already done outside.
Okay.
Dr. Anand has a second question. Dr. Anand, would you like to unmute and ask a question?
Dr. Anand, you can unmute yourself.
Uh,
or I can ask on his behalf.
Yeah, hello. Good morning. I just want to know that patient is having a deranged renal profile for which we have to modify the meropenem, but we continue with the LMWX 60 mg BD for the same patient at the same time. So how it is justifiable?
Yeah,
resident, so please. Ma'am, please ask. This is for the resident.
Good morning, sir. Sir, yes. On day 4, we didn't show the renal profile, but by day 4, her AKI had settled. And her meropenem was also modified to normal dose by day 4.
Okay, and why not the patient go for the acute thrombolysis immediately? Means what was the patient's family member's inhibition? Why they choose not to go for thrombolysis, acute MI treatment? Because this is in hospital MI, na? This is ST segment elevation, acute coronary disease. So patient is in hospital and within the MI, the ST segment elevation was there. So why not a patient choose to go for the thrombolysis treatment? What was their inhibition?
Sir, at that time, the patient was quite sick. So he chose not to give consent for...
This is like a MI. You mean to say that the patient is having MI and patient refused for treatment because he is sick?
So, Dr. Anand, I'll just intervene over here. This patient was actually a mother of an SR of this hospital. He decided not to give that thrombolysis. And very, very surprisingly, all the changes, ECG changes, it all came back to normal within 4 hours. So, 4 to 5 hours. The next ECG was totally normal. So, that was his choice. It was not our choice. In fact, the SR from cardiology who saw it and prescribed it was his friend. So that was his decision. We had nothing to do with it.
Okay. Can this MI is related with this disease itself?
Could be. See, it could be stress related. Dr. Vikas, do you want to take it? But it could have been stress related. But I'll ask Dr. Vikas to take this question. I think he's more qualified for it.
Yeah, thanks. Regarding the first part, thrombolysis part, I just wanted to come in. Thrombolysis, consent for a thrombolysis is very important because of the increased bleeding risk and intracranial bleed that is also associated with thrombolysis. So it's mandatory to obtain a consent with the relatives or after complete, detailed inquiry with the patient and the patient relatives that we proceed with thrombolysis. So consent is one major part of undergoing a thrombolysis for the patient. Secondly, regarding that part of could this be related to Still's disease? It could be. Still's disease is also a pro-inflammatory state, and looking at his, I think he was COVID positive also. So procoagulant state, inflammatory state, but nothing in the literature would suggest that there's a direct link between the Still's disease and myocardial infarction or acute coronary syndrome. Still's disease being a pro-inflammatory state, there have been reports of more cases of myocarditis associated with Still's disease as opposed to acute coronary syndrome. But looking at a profile, diabetic female, lot of comorbidities, age and everything, coronary atherosclerosis and acute myocardial infarction would be the first possibility looking at ECG that you would think about in this patient. So it could be a coincidence or it could be but there is no direct link between Still's disease and myocardial infarction or acute coronary syndrome. There are more reports of myocarditis associated with Still's disease.
For the next question, may I request Professor Sanjeev Gupta sir to unmute himself and ask his question.
Dr. Sanjeev, sir, you can unmute yourself.
Yeah, thank you. My first question is that this patient developed features of MI in the hospital and the ECG showed changes, but the first cardiac biomarker was normal. So how long does it take for the cardiac biomarkers to become abnormal? The subsequent cardiac biomarker profile was deranged, but the first one was normal, even though there were ECG changes.
Dr. Vikas, will you take that question?
Yeah. There is always a lag between the first symptoms of chest pain and the elevation of biomarkers. Biomarkers generally take time to elevate. Troponin, in this case, what the biomarker that we use most frequently, troponin I or T, generally take around 2 to 3 hours to start rising after acute coronary syndrome, especially after myocardial infarction. So once ECG could be the first change, you can get hyperacute changes on the ECG. Hyperacute changes are the earliest that you see on the ECG. These are basically peak T waves or ST elevation on the ECG. That is the first marker with chest pain that you see. Biomarkers rise, troponins rise after 2 to 3 hours. They peak by around maybe around 12 to 48 hours that you get the peak of the troponins. And then they generally come down slowly, and it takes around 10 to 12 days or 14 days for them to normalize. So this is, it rises slowly, and there's always around 14 days for the troponin levels to normalize. So this is how, so you just can't rely on the cardiac markers. The first value of the cardiac biomarker would not be reliable, and you have to go by the symptoms and the ECG changes to, you know, decide upon the treatment.
So why should it be done in the first place? Why should we do cardiac biomarkers? There are ECG changes.
Yeah, it's important because just to be sure, a lot of times, you know, you get the second reading that is positive, but a profile of the cardiac marker is also important. So you see how it rises and how it falls. The amount of elevation of cardiac marker is also prognostic. So you just do a profiling, because a lot of times symptoms, maybe in this patient, I would not say, but a lot of times the symptoms are vague. The chest pain, they say, started one hour back or 2 hours back or 3 hours back. And it's really very difficult to correlate upon the symptoms and the, you know, the how to proceed about. So generally we do in most of the cases and see how the profiling of the cardiomyocyte level is. Somebody who has undergone thrombolysis or spontaneous recanalization, the cardiac marker rise and fall is pretty faster in those patients. Somebody with thrombolysis, there is a early peak and a early downfall of the cardiac marker. So profiling of the cardiac marker is important, and generally we do multiple cardiac biomarkers to see how the rise is and how the fall is, and that is how we monitor these patients.
Okay, thank you. What was the vaccination status, COVID vaccination status of this patient?
Sir, she was not vaccinated.
Okay, and how long will you continue the steroids?
Sir, as far as steroids concerned, sir, there is no fixed duration for which we need to continue. We generally,
this patient, sir, we stopped the steroids. We continued the whole full dose for 1 month, and then we tapered it off, and the patient is off steroid at this point, and she's still in follow-up.
Okay, thank you very much.
I would just, because it's already 8:30, I'll just summarize this case. You was definitely a dilemma for all of us, all the clinicians, especially in all medical and medicine specialties. And the first thing for us is always tuberculosis. And like this patient was already given ATT. When you come to Still's disease, usually our mindset is that it'll have some articular presentation. But in this case, as we showed you, the patient did not have any joint pain. And this was a systemic form of Still's disease. And giving steroids in a patient who's already diabetic with a raised leukocytosis, it's very, very difficult for the clinicians, and you don't have a definitive diagnosis. You just have to go with criteria, like we showed you the Yamaguchi criteria. So that is why we presented this case. So everything is not infection. It could be immune mediated too. Thank you. Anybody else, if you have any questions, please put it in the chat box so that we can answer it in the chat box. And with this, we come to the end of the first presentation. And I would like to invite Professor Vivek Srivastava to coordinate the second presentation from Unit C of Surgery.
Am I audible?
Yes.
A very good morning to all of you. Now we'll be starting the second presentation from Unit C Department of Surgery. That is a very interesting case of a young lady who presented with a rare endocrine disorder. Dr. Hemant, JR3 is going to present the case. Over to you, Dr. Hemant.
Thank you, sir. Good morning to all. Today, I'll be presenting an interesting case from Department of General Surgery, Unit C, a young lady with rare endocrine disorder. 32 years lady, homemaker, resident of Chandauli, presented to General Surgery OPD in August of this year with chief complaints of left flank pain for 5 months, vomiting for 5 months, and headache for 1 month. As stated by the patient, she was apparently well 5 months back when she developed pain in left flank, which was insidious in onset, gradually progressive, dull aching. There were no aggravating factors and the pain relieved on taking medications. She also had occasional episodes of vomiting, which is non-projectile, non-bilious, and relieved on taking medication. She also complained of headache in the back of head for past 1 month. She got admitted in EOPD SSH BHU for the complaint of vomiting and pain, and after conservative management was discharged and kept on OPD follow-up before being referred to surgery. There was no history of fever, hematemesis or melena, bowel abnormality, distension abdomen or lump abdomen, any sort of urinary complaints, seizure episode, visual disturbances, tinnitus or vertigo, any sensory or motor deficit. She took ATT for 6 months for pulmonary cox in the year 2009, and which was cured as per the treating doctor. So she stopped there. There was no history of known comorbidity. There was no history of any surgical intervention in past. She took mixed diet, bowel and bladder habits are regular. There was no history of any substance abuse or any known drug allergy. She has history of oligomenorrhea with irregular cycles. She was an alliparous woman with a married life of 8 years for which she was consulting to a gynecologist outside. There was no history of any similar illness in family members, and she was on symptomatic treatment for the above complaints. The patient was examined in a well-lit room after taking proper informed consent in a comfortable position in the presence of a female chaperone. Patient was conscious, well-oriented to time, place, and person, with height of 162 centimeter, weight of 78 kg, with a BMI of 29 kg per meter square and a Karnofsky score of 90. Vitals, the patient was afebrile, pulse was 96 per minute in right radial artery, BP was 130 by 90 in right arm supine position, and respiratory rate was 16 per minute abdominal thoracic. On general examination, there was no pallor, atrius, cyanosis, clubbing, pedal edema, or generalized lymphadenopathy, and there were no skin lesions noted in any of the body parts. Cardiovascular system, respiratory system, and central nervous system examination were essentially normal. On thoracic examination, on inspection, the contour was normal. Umbilicus was centrally placed, inverted. All quadrants moved proportionately with respiration. There was no visible peristalsis, pulsations, scar marks, or venous engorgement. Renal angles were not full, and hernia auspices were normal. On palpation, abdomen was soft. There was no local rise of temperature. It was non-tender, and there was no lump or organ palpable. On percussion, there was no evidence of any free fluid, and the renal angles were resonant. On auscultation, bowel sounds were normal, and there was no bruit heart. On pervaginal and rectal examination, there was no abnormal findings. An examination of back and spine was within normal limits. Summarizing my history and examination, a 32 years lady presented with episodic left flank pain for 5 months, associated with occasional episodes of vomiting and headache for 1 month, without any bladder or bowel symptoms. There was history of oligomenorrhea and primary infertility, but the clinical examination was apparently normal. So on the basis of history and examination, a differential diagnosis of Cox abdomen or ureter calculus or renal calculus was kept. When the patient presented to us, she had some investigations previously done, the ultrasound and CT. The ultrasound showed bilateral kidneys were enlarged in size with presence of multiple cysts in both the kidneys. Pancreas was enlarged in size with presence of multiple cystic and few solid components arising from head, body, and tail of pancreas, and a 3 into 3 centimeter hemorrhagic cyst noted in the right ovary. Now I'd like to invite Dr. Ishan Singh from the Department of Radiology to kindly give his comments on the radiology part.
Dr. Ishan, you can unmute and
take over the CT films.
Am I audible?
Yes, Dr. Ishan.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Hemant. So this is contrast enhanced CT of abdomen, which includes pelvic scan also. So in this first image, this is an axial section. We can see, first of all, the both kidneys are slightly enlarged and there are multiple cysts involving both kidneys. So one of the cysts in the left kidney shows a solid component as well. I would request Dr. Hemant to just point out, apart from the kidneys, there are multiple cysts in the visualized head of pancreas. Some of the cysts are hyperdense, which shows internal hemorrhagic or complex contents. And the black arrow points towards a large, approximately 9-10 centimeter mass in the retroperitoneum involving left anterior pararenal space. So the lesion is strongly enhancing peripherally, and there is central cystic and necrotic components. Further sections, we can see the extent of this retroperitoneal mass. It is extending in the left suprarenal region. And we can see in the lower pole of left kidney that there are solid cystic lesion, complex cystic lesion, which corresponds to Bosniak type 4 lesions, which suggests cystic renal cell carcinomas. So there is left suprarenal mass, multiple pancreatic cyst, multiple renal cyst, and cystic renal cell carcinomas. Again, in the next coronal section, we can appreciate in the first image that there is left suprarenal mass, and also there is a smaller right suprarenal mass. So there are bilateral suprarenal masses. Adrenals are not visualized separately, so we can suspect that these lesions are arising from adrenals. And in the second image, the black arrows points towards the highly complex cystic lesions of kidney, which suggests cystic renal cell carcinomas. Next image, please. So again, the brain, MRI of the brain and spine is also, at this point, we are suspecting some syndromic association of the tumors involving pancreas, kidney, and adrenals. So in the brain, we can see in the right cerebellar hemisphere, there is a cystic lesion with a small septation. And in the second image, which is axial section, contrast enhanced MRI. So we can see that cystic lesion is peripherally enhancing and there is an associated solid mural nodule. And again, there is another cystic lesion on the left side involving the left cerebellar peduncle, inferior cerebellar peduncle, which is seen extending to the foramen of magnum. Change the image. So yes, we can see superiorly the cystic lesion is extending to the foramen magnum, and there are multiple spinal cord nodules also, spinal cord T2 hyperintense lesion, which showed enhancement on contrast enhanced images. So these lesions correspond to, so cystic lesion with mural nodule only has two diagnoses. One is hemangioblastoma and one is pilocytic astrocytoma. So at this stage, this is a middle-aged female. So at this stage, hemangioblastoma should be suspected. So we have a constellation of tumors consisting of multiple hemangioblastomas involving brain and spinal cord, multiple pancreatic cyst, complex pancreatic cyst, multiple renal cyst, cystic renal cell carcinoma, and bilateral adrenal masses. So considering that there is high peripheral enhancement of these lesions, adrenal lesions, we suspect that these are fused chromocytoma. So given all these tumors, the overall diagnosis will be von Hippel-Lindau syndrome. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. So on the basis of above lesions in various organs and with endocrinology consultation, further evaluation was done on the line of VHL. Plasma free metanephrines was done, which was within normal limits. Plasma free normetanephrines was done, which was raised to around 695. 3-methoxytyramine was done, which was within normal limits. Morning serum cortisol was done, which was lower, 1.34 microgram per deciliter. Indirect ophthalmoscopy was done to rule out any retinal hemangioblastomas, which was which was found to be normal, and audiometry was done for any hearing loss, which was within normal limits. So on the basis of multiple lesions involving various organs and to rule out any presence of metastasis or extra adrenal lesions, 68 gallium dotanate PET CT scan was done, which was performed in SDPGI as per referred from the endocrinology department on 11th of June 2021. The films are shown here. The films showed multiple non-tracer avid areas noted with cystic lesions in right cerebellar hemisphere and in medulla oblongata, ill-defined exophytic heterogeneous density lesions in bilateral kidney, heterogeneous density lesions in bilateral adrenal gland, left more larger than right, and the pancreas is bulky with multiple variable size cystic lesions noted in the head, mainly in the head, without any evidence of metastasis. On further inquiry in the family, the pedigree analysis was done, and which showed that there was an elder brother with three children without any with no affected individual in the family. While since she was a nulliparous woman, no further children were there in her family, and the rest of the family members did not have the similar illness. So on the basis of history examination and the radiological findings, then the final diagnosis of von Hippel-Lindau disease with bilateral pheochromocytoma, with bilateral renal cell carcinoma, with pancreatic and ovarian cysts, with cerebellar, medullary, and spinal hemangioblastomas without any evidence of metastasis was made. The patient was admitted and planned for surgery, and pre-anesthetic checkup investigations were done. CBC, LFT, RFT, ECG, and chest X-ray were done, which is within normal limits. A workup of primary infertility was done with hormonal levels of LH, FSH, prolactin on day two of cycle, which were within normal limits. T3, T4, TSH were done, which were also within our normal limits. Serum anti-Müllerian hormone was done, which was also within normal limits, and husband semen analysis was also normal. So a plan of bilateral partial adrenalectomy with bilateral partial nephrectomy, followed by excision of cerebellar hemangioblastoma, which had to be done in the second setting, was planned. Due to the presence of larger size and multiple lesions, bilateral adrenalectomy was done with bilateral partial nephrectomy with distal pancreatectomy under general anesthesia after taking proper precautions regarding the BP in view of pheochromocytoma. The patient was explored with bilateral subcostal incision or chevron incision, and bilateral adrenalectomy was performed. Further, the urology team was involved in bilateral renal cell carcinoma. Malignant and bilateral partial nephrectomy was done. The picture here shows the right kidney with multiple solid cystic lesions. Here's the gallbladder and the looped renal artery, renal vein, and ureter. While on the other side, the other picture shows the left kidney with multiple solid cystic lesions. Here shows the gross specimens after resection. The picture here shows the right adrenal, which was around 4 into 4.3 centimeter, while the other gross shows the right partial nephrectomy specimen of 6.5 into 5 centimeter. The picture here shows the specimen of left adrenal with distal pancreatectomy with multiple cysts of around 15 into 4.5 centimeter. And the picture here shows the left partial nephrectomy specimen of around 7.5 into 7 centimeter. So the patient, after operating the patient in view of monitoring with regard to vitals and ABIS monitoring was shifted to ICU. And after stabilization, the patient was shifted back to surgery ward on post-op day two. And in view of bilateral adrenalectomy, injection hydrocortisone 50 mg BD was added in view of endocrinology consultation. The patient was managed on the current treatment protocol. While on post-op day 7, she developed postural hypertension with supine BP of 130/80 and a sitting BP of 104/68 with severe vertigo, while the serum electrolytes and sugar was normal. Neurosurgery consultation was sorted, and injection mannitol 100 ml IV TDS, tablet beta-histidine 24 mg BD, tablet dexamethasone 8 mg TDS, and tablet cinnarizine 25 mg BD were added. The patient showed improvement but developed a syncopal attack in ward on post-op day 17 with persistence of postural hypertension. And in view of monitoring and due to persistent postural hypertension, the patient was shifted to surgical ICU and tablet hydrocortisone 20 in the dose of 20-10-10 was added with the endocrinology consultation. On POD, the patient still did not improve and there was persistence of postural hypertension. So on post-op day 20, according to endocrinology consultation, injection hydrocortisone 100 mg IV infusion at the rate of 10 mg per hour was added along with tablet fludrocort 100 microgram OD. And the infusion was further increased to 13 mg per hour as she did not improve. On post-op day 22, she landed in shock and was not able to maintain BP even with ionotropic support. Her saturation levels on room air was 76%. GCS dropped to 10 by 15 with RBS of 71 milligram per deciliter and serum electrolytes were still normal. And the patient, did not improve and was deteriorating. ICU shifting was tried, but however, due to poor affordability, patient could not be shifted to ICU and succumbed on post-op day 23. Here are the post-op investigations, which showed a trend. There was on post-op day one, there was increased total leukocyte count to around 31,000, which gradually decreased, but still on post-op day 22, they were higher on higher side, 12,000. Differential counts showed neutrophilia, persistent neutrophilia, while LFT was within normal limits. Serum creatinine levels on post-op day one were 1.8 and urea levels were 55, which gradually improved, but on post-op day two, the creatinine levels were 2 and the urea level was 79, which were increased, while the serum electrolytes remained within normal limits all throughout. So cause of death was sorted as probably due to post-bilateral adrenalectomy, adrenal insufficiency with septicemia with VHL disease. Now I'd like to invite Dr. Paramita from Department of Pathology to give her views on the pathology part.
Good morning, everyone. For this, we received the adrenalectomy specimens, bilateral partial nephrectomy specimens, and the distal pancreatectomy specimen. So coming to the adrenal specimen, grossly, we can see that it is well encapsulated and weighed about 56 gram. The normal weight is usually 5 to 6 gram, and the cut surface showed some gray, white, and tan areas. On microscopy, we can appreciate that this is the cortical part, which comprises of the glomerulosa, fasciculata, and the reticularis, and the medulla is expanded. And on higher power, we can see that the constituent cells are largely isomorphic, and they are disposed in a pattern, ball-like pattern, which is called the classical Zell-Balin pattern. And these are intricately surrounded by this thin vasculature, the vascular network. Now coming to the bilateral nephrectomies, grossly the left partial nephrectomy showed somewhat variegated appearance with some small cystic areas and some mucoid areas and some yellow areas. The right partial nephrectomy was grossly cystic as can be appreciated in the outer surface as well as the cut surface, which shows multiple cystic spaces which were filled with serous fluid as well as some hemorrhagic areas. So coming to the microscopy, one can appreciate that there is more of clearing rather than the pink appearance of cytoplasm. The tumor cells are disposed in an alveolar pattern and the constituent cells had prominent cytoplasmic membrane with abundant clear cytoplasm and isomorphic nucleus. The nucleoli were hardly discernible at somewhere seen in the higher magnification. The other kidney was largely cystic, but the cystic spaces were again lined by these tumor cells. So the bilateral nephrectomy was reported as clear cell renal cell carcinoma. The WHO ISUP grade would be grade 1 based on the nuclear morphology. The stage would be PT1B because the size ranged from 4 to 7 centimeter. There was no capsular invasion. Now coming to the last specimen, that is the distal pancreatectomy specimen. Again, this was grossly cystic in appearance. And the cut surface showed somewhat spongy appearance with cysts of variable size and one large macrocyst. On microscopy, we can see this is the normal pancreas with some acinar architecture, while the cystic areas showed this cysts of variable size. The one of the largest cysts showed some papillary infoldings, and on higher power, one can again appreciate these clear cells, which is again intricately surrounded by this rich vasculature network. So this was reported as serous cystadenoma of the pancreas, and the constellation of this histological findings would fit into the VHL syndrome. Thanks.
Thank you, ma'am. Coming on to discussion, von Hippel-Lindau is a rare autosomal dominant disorder due to deletion or mutation in the VHL gene present on short arm of chromosome 3.
Sorry to interrupt, Hemant. Yes. Just sum it up in 1 or 2 minutes because you've already exceeded your time.
Yes, okay. Just 1 minute, I'll be telling. Vascular tumors of CNS and other tumors are specific solid organs. There is 100% penetrance till 65 years, and diagnosis is established by the presence of two CNS, such as cerebellar hemangioblastomas, retinal angiomatoma, endolymphatic sac tumors, or spinal cord lesions, or one CNS and one other organs, as per se. And there are two types of VHL syndromes. One is predominantly without pheochromocytoma, while the other is with pheochromocytoma, which is further subdivided into 2A without RCC, 2B, which was our patient, with clear cell RCC, and 2C, only pheochromocytoma is seen. Coming on to management, surgeries prefer treatment in non-metastatic disease. Multidisciplinary approach is required in such patients. Renal and cerebellar tumors are the leading cause of death. Pheochromocytoma, if present, should be operated before any other surgery. Percutaneous ablation is suboptimal in larger tumors, while nephron-sparing surgery is preferred for clear cell non-metastatic RCC. In case of metastatic disease, VEGF targeting agents such as bevacizumab and tyrosine kinase inhibitors such as sunitinib play a reasonable role, and genetic counseling plays a key role in VHL if diagnosed. And here are the screening protocol in the at-risk individuals. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Hemant. I think presented a rare endocrine disorder with a florid presentation of different organs involving and different specialties which were involved. So I would like to have comments from Professor S.K. Singh, sir. Professor S.K. Singh, sir. Okay, in the meantime, Professor Ravi Shankar is there, so he can give his comments regarding the hemangioblastoma which was present. Dr. Ravi, you can unmute yourself. Dr. Ravi, are you able to hear?
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, please.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Vivek. Actually, hemangioblastomas are not very uncommon tumors of brain, especially the cerebellum. It is, in fact, very common and it is one of the commonest primary tumors of the cerebellum. Apart from the cerebellum, it also is present in the brain stem or spinal cord. So but most of the cases, about 70 to 80% of the cases are sporadic, and only 20% of the cases are associated with VHL. So For that reason, this is really a rare case. VHL, we have seen only very few cases during this. I think this was very nicely managed case. And in fact, this is very true that few patients of VHL having pheochromocytomas, the pheochromocytoma has to be dealt first. So over to you, Vivek.
Thank you.
Before you go further, can we ask Dr. Sanjeev Gupta, sir? He has a question, so we'll ask him to unmute and ask his questions. Dr. Sanjeev Gupta, sir, you can unmute, sir.
So, sir has asked that could have been presented in the mortality meeting. That's very true. But I think mortality meet, why we chose to present this case here, because of the rarity of the case. So, CSM usually, I think, should have case-based importance rather than mortality is always important. So, here the rarity of the case, we thought that superseded the mortality. But no doubt, we tried, but unfortunately, the patient succumbed.
Okay, my other question was, What was the reason for this infertility and the oligomenorrhea? Was it explained by the disease or is no, there some difference?
No, sir. We did all the work for the primary fertility and took consultation from the obstetrics and gynecology department itself. But there was no cause found as such. And it was not related and also not related to the disease per se.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
I think Dr. Vivek, there's another question from Dr. Anand. Dr. Anand, yes. You can unmute.
Yeah. Hello. Good morning. I just want to know that the DD you just, can you mention the DD, whatever you have kept in initially before the starting the your evaluation?
Yes. So we, on the basis of the history and examination, we thought of a differential of Cox abdomen since she had a past history of pulmonary Cox itself.
Yes.
She had symptoms of pain.
Another differential diagnosis?
And that was urinary calculus or renal calculus.
So how you are going to explain headache with these two differential diagnoses, Cox abdomen and urinary calculus, how the headache can be there? Because it was your chief complaint clinically, history. So.
Yes, sir. Because of the presence of headache, sir, it was less likely to be a urinary or renal calculus. While, sir, in case of Cox abdomen, sir, it could be a non-specific presentation.
No, but it was your chief complaint. How can you just nullify that chief complaint?
Yes,
so instead of keeping a Cox, I would say you should better to keep as a disseminated Cox. So it Cox can be there in abdomen, can be there in the brain. So it would be a better differential diagnosis than that of the Cox abdomen. And there are other things to just, because if you say the chief complaint, that is a pain abdomen, vomiting and headache. So there are the N number of differential diagnoses. Why you kept only two? So clinically you should have a better assessment. So because the imaging, brain imaging were done after the getting the chest abdomen CT, but it should be done a priori if you consider this headache as a important symptoms, but you nullify that important chief complaint, that is not good for the training purposes. And second question I would like to say that whether the VHL diagnosis was confirmed genetically also, or it was just because of constellation of these symptoms.
So we had, she already had investigations done from outside and
Let me answer this. So it was not genetically tested because this facility is not available in our university and it is very costly. So we tried to do that, but unfortunately the post-operative period was very, stormy and the patient's family was quite devastated with all the diagnosis which was made during the course of her investigations which was done. So regarding the headache, I think headache was not that much primary complaint, and since the patient had just apparently normal examination finding and the ultrasound which showed multiple cystic lesion in the kidney and the pancreas, so that's why we went for I think we did not do that. All the CT MRI was done before the patient presented to us. But whoever might advise, it was because of the patient presented with a acute episodic pain, abdomen and vomiting in the emergency where ultrasound was done, and that probably opened the Pandora box.
But sir, I think because of that much of big lesion in the cerebellum and the nearby the brainstem area, it is less likely to be a completely asymptomatic neurological examination. It must have some subtle symptoms or a signs that may be probably missed. But I think if it is considered as one of the chief complaint, that should be given some sort of credentials.
Okay, your point is taken.
I'm trying to unmute Dr. S.K. Singh. We cannot find him over here. But Dr. Rahul Khanna can ask his question by that time. We are trying to unmute Dr. S.K. Singh.
Thank you, Dr. Jaya. Well matched ultimately. But I think the headache was because of the hemangioedema of the cerebellum, and not because of the hypertension. So my concern is, if the pheochromocytoma was functional, then by doing bilateral adenolectomy, we land up with all the problems associated with the hypocortisolism, which ultimately led to a unfortunate demise, that she lost her cortisol levels very rapidly. And we did not gain anything as far as the hypertension element aspect was concerned, because she was normotensive right from the beginning. So that is one concern that I've got, that the chromocytoma is probably there, but non-functional variety.
So, sir, whenever we see the pheochromocytoma, they could be.
Can I give my comments because we are running of time?
Sure.
Hello.
Sir.
Now I got my mic on. A good case. We actually is very very uncommon, and I think we had only two cases in last 20 years. So this was one of them. VHL. And it was a proven VHL, though genetic study was not done, but this constellation of the endocrine disorders with cystic lesions in organs, that confirms almost, and genetic study may not be much helpful as there is no family involvement, and counseling purposes only the genetic study is necessary. Otherwise, it may not be that important in sporadic cases of VHL. The functionality of VO, it was functional as metanephrines were raised, normetanephrine was raised. It means it was producing, but a pheochromocytoma hypertension is very complex. All of them, only 30-40% may have hypertension, others may not have, even it is functional. The reason being that there are many vasodilator agents are also being produced. It's not only the catecholamine, which is vasopressor, vasodilators are also produced by these tumors. So it's very difficult, and many times they do not have hypertension, though it is functional, and it was bilateral. In this case, the RCC was also in early stage two, I would say more than 7 centimeter stage two, along with pheo and no paraganglioma, as the Dottanak scan has also shown there is no paraganglioma. So we thought that surgery might be helpful in this case. Only going for renal cell surgery for renal cell carcinoma and also adenectomy, and they have also removed the pancreatic cyst. Though that may not be a problem, but we definitely wanted to know if it is PNET, that is pancreatic neuroendocrine tumor, and therefore surgery is also indicated to know about it. Otherwise, many times cystic lesion may not be a problem, as this could be a only benign lesion. So I think we lost this case. We thought that we have picked up the diagnosis in early stage, and maybe chemotherapy or newer chemotherapy, if affordable, can be of some help to this patient. But overall, average lifespan of VHL patients is around 42 years plus minus 12 years. So we cannot completely solve these cases, and that was the reason we took it in the clinical society. But mortality meet also, this can be discussed. Our mortality meeting, such a rare tumor, I think that may not be. We know that mortality will always be there in this case. Nothing much can be done. So this is how it is justified to put it in clinical society meeting.
Thank you, sir.
Dr. Vivek, can you just summarize, then we can.
Yes, thank you, ma'am. I think this rarity of the case has been highlighted with a very florid presentation. And one rare presentation was that, in spite of having so much of big POs and big cerebellar, the patient lesion, the patient was not that much symptomatic. We tried to manage with a multidisciplinary approach involving endocrinology, neurosurgery, urology. There was a big help from Professor Samir Trivedi in doing assisting in the renal part. We tried to manage the patient in the post-operative period, but surprisingly, the adrenal insufficiency was the event which led to an increased dose of steroids, and probably the patient landed up with insufficiency along with the septicemia and succumbed. So thank you very much, madam.
Thank you, Dr. Vivek. May I request Director Sir to give his final comments?
Thank you, Professor Jaya. Already we are running over time. 7 minutes are already over. Anyhow, the second case is a rare case, well presented, and lot of discussion also. Only comment while presenting that in ICU could not be shifted because of affordability. Outcome, we already know such cases should not be discussed like that because of affordability. And even if required, you know, it can be worked out. Because of affordability, if you know patient can be saved, then why to say because of affordability it could not be shifted? That is my only point in this case, though outcome was known. In the first case, patient very well worked up and well presented. And again, only comment is that you told that the CT scan was already done outside. We didn't present here, though maybe DICOM images may not be available, but few sections, few images could have been shown. That is always complete the case because it's the academic discussion. Otherwise, first case also well worked out, well presented and well treated. Patient is doing fine. Second case, unfortunately, though the outcome is already known in this case, lot many organs involved in VHL and they did their best. There's only already a lot of discussion. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. With this, we conclude today's session of Clinical Society meeting. Thank you. And I'm sorry, I'm not Dr. Abhishek. He coordinates it much better. So we'll wait for Dr. Abhishek to coordinate next time. Thank you so much.
Thank you.